doing something that we have never seen heretofore. I believe that God is setting us up to see him move in a way that many of you have never experienced in your life. Oftentimes, a hindrance of the new move of God is the old move of God. We get used to how we've seen God moved in times past until we seem to think that that's all there is to God. One of the dangers in the body of Christ is becoming familiar with the move of God until the move of God no longer fascinates you. You get to a place where God has to keep proving himself and has to keep performing in order to get you to respond, because you have become familiar with how God moves. But God is getting ready to do something that your eyes have not yet seen. I know you've experienced the presence of God. You've heard the voice of God. But there's something fresh that's getting ready to hit your life. Get ready for the unusual. Get ready for the peculiar. Get ready for the strange. God is getting ready to do something fresh. When you look at the body of Christ and you look at the church at large, and even the church in the Bible day, the church was built on three principles. The church, number one, was built on prayer. It wasn't built on entertainment. It wasn't built on a praise break. It wasn't built on excitement. The church was built on prayer. I remember the days when people didn't even start church until they hit the altar first. We in a culture where people want to perform, but they don't want to pray. They want to preach, but they don't want to pray. But the Bible makes it biblically clear that if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray. The church was built on prayer, but the church was built on power. I grew up in the church where they didn't have degrees, they didn't have fancy churches, they didn't have cushioned pews, but they had prayer. Mothers knew how to drive demons out. And come on, think about our church culture now. When was the last time you saw a demon cast out? When was the last time you seen somebody purge until they changed their language? When was the last time, by the power of the Holy Ghost, God took the taste out of folks' mouth? There's no way in the world you can say that the power of God is in the church and we come in the same way and leave the same way. If the power of God is really real, something ought to happen. If the power of God is really real, yokes ought to be destroyed. I dare you to look down your row and look at somebody and tell them, we need power. We need power. The church was built on prayer. The church was built on power. But I'm going to park here when I tell you the church was built on persecution. This is the part that people don't want to deal with, because we seem to think that because we're saved and because we name the name of Christ that everything ought to be easy. Some of you are frustrated in your walk even now because you want to know, how in the world can I give and praise and be faithful? But yet all hell breaks loose. I mean, there's somebody in here, you don't want to tell nobody because it's not good church and Christian terminology to tell people that you're frustrated, tired of giving more than you receive, tired of loving folk that don't love you back, tired of giving when you just can't afford to. But God sent me to tell somebody that payday is coming. Y'all didn't come to have church. Do me a favor, look at somebody. Payday is coming. Payday. Tell your neighbor, payday is coming. Persecution is a part of the plan. Persecution is a part of promotion. If you can't handle folk talking about you, you're not ready. You can't handle folk not speaking to you, you're not ready. If you can't handle warfare, if you can't handle uncomfortable seasons, you're not ready for the next level. Persecution is what connects you to power. When you look at this particular pericope, you will discover that the church is now being persecuted. Verse number one, the Bible says, in those days, King Herod stretched forth his hand to vex the church. His job was to keep the church in their emotions, to keep them in their feelings, to keep them aggravated and keep them frustrated. You got to be careful when the enemy knows how to push your buttons, knows how to get you out of your character. You can't faithfully follow the Father in your feelings. And the reason why many of us are missing our opportunity to go to the next level, because we stay in our emotions. We stay mad. We stay aggravated. We stay frustrated. We stay in our feelings. Isn't it amazing that we can talk about how good God is on Facebook on Monday, but by Thursday we cussing folk out in our emotions, in our flesh? You can speak to me this week and roll your eyes the next week. Come to church and shout this week. The next week you don't even want to wave your hands in your feelings. And God said to me to tell you that if you're going to handle elevation, you got to get out of your emotions. And the Bible says that the church is now vexed. The Bible says that now that the church is vexed, the Bible says that they're vexed because James has now been killed. The Bible says when they saw that it pleased the Jews, they apprehended Peter as well. Their plan was to kill Peter, but instead they placed him in prison. The Bible says that while Peter is in prison, he's asleep. When you look at this particular text, sleep would represent two things. Because the question is, how in the world can you be in prison and know that the enemy wants to kill you, but you sleep? Sleep, number one, can suggest that one is depressed. Those who have been in prison would even testify that they sleep and sleep hoping that they can numb themselves of the reality. And sometimes sleep is a sign of depression. This room, the spirit of depression, that spirit that keeps you smiling but you're in despondency, that spirit that calls you to cry and take sleep, that spirit that controls your mind. I come against depression, I come against suicide, I come against that spirit that make you take pills to sleep and pills for energy. And I wish I had somebody. The church has become a happy place for sad people. We come in here, we put on our good clothes, we shout and we dance, but we're frustrated. We go to jobs that we don't like, we in homes that we don't want to be in, we in relationships that we're disgusted, but the devil is alive. I refuse to shout and be miserable, speak in tongues and be unhappy. I tell you to look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, I refuse to be unhappy. Hallelujah. But then sleep will represent peace, because you have to have peace to know there's a hit out on your life. But then you relax it. Know that people don't like you, but you still sleeping. You got to have some peace to lose everything you have and still come to church with your hands lifted. You got to have a relationship with God that says, though you slay me, yet will I trust you. I dare you to lift your hands and tell God, thank you. Peter is now sleeping. The Bible says that while he's in prison, the Bible says that the angel comes now and taps Peter on the side and tells Peter to get up. Pause, rewind. The Bible says that while he's in prison, the church is at the house praying. While he's there, verse 5 says that the people are now praying church is praying endlessly. The church is praying entirely. The church is praying exclusively. But they're not praying expectantly. Let's try it again. The church is praying endlessly. The Bible says they're praying without ceasing. The church is praying entirely. That means the whole church is praying. The church is praying exclusively. That means everybody is praying for one thing. Although they're endlessly. Although they're doing it entirely. Although they're doing it exclusively. They're not doing it expectantly. Although they're praying. They still don't believe it's going to happen. How many times have you gotten on your knees and prayed and still doubted? Prayed but still didn't believe he was going to heal you. Prayed and still didn't believe you're going to get the job. I mean, if you're going to get on your knees and pray, at least look for a miracle. If you're going to get on your knees and pray, at least go to the mailbox looking for a check. If you're going to pray, look for it. I beg you to look down your row and tell your neighbor, look for it, look for it. Hallelujah. Bible said this boy is in prison. And the angel comes and hits him on the side and tells Peter, get up. Peter, I need you to get up and put on your clothes and put on your shoes. The angel tells Peter, I need you to get up. I need you to put on your sandals and gird yourself. Peter, we get ready to come out. But before I can get you out, I need you to put on your shoes and put on your clothes. It is, Peter, I'm getting ready to get you out. But before I can get you out, at least look like you're ready to come out. The reason why many of you ain't out yet, because you're not dressed for the occasion. You look like you want to be bound. You look like you won't stay there. Peter had gotten comfortable. He done took off his clothes, done laid down, because he thought he was going to be there a while. But honey, when you know that your miracle is right around the corner, you don't get comfortable in your trial. You don't get comfortable in your storm. I dare you to look at somebody next to you and tell them, I won't be here long. Y'all ain't talking to nobody. Look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, I won't be here long. I may be broke now, but not for long. I may be suffering now, but not for long. Weeping may endure for a night. But somebody open your big mouth and shout joy. Hallelujah. God tells him, get up. To bring you out. The Bible says that Peter is now in a place where he's so shocked that the text says that he thought he was having a dream. The Bible says that they get ready to go out. The Bible says that they're going to the iron gate that leads to the city. This gate is heavy and hard. The Bible says that when they go out, the Bible says that the door opens on its own accord. Hallelujah. Try it again. This door is an iron gate. This door is heavy and hard. But the Bible says that when they come to the gate, the door opens on its own accord. Me and my son was in Walmart. We was getting ready to leave, but while we were walking out, my son was lagging behind me. I looked around, he was just playing with the door. He couldn't understand how the door was
just opening. No key, no password, no voice. It was just opening. It opened up when it showed up. You don't know when to shout. God said to tell you that in this next season, it will open up when you show up. You're not going to need force. You're not going to need a key. You're in the season of the automatic. I dare you to prophesy to your neighbor and tell your neighbor it's going to happen automatically. I don't care about your degree. I don't care about your credit score. I don't care who don't want you to have it. You're in the season of the automatic. I beg you to lift your hand and tell him thank you. Hallelujah. I'm almost out of here, but the text is tailored to teachers. Number one, that God is going to give you clarity in spite of the calamity. Verse 11 says, and when Peter was come to himself, he says, now I know for a certainty. He said, I was guessing before. I was hoping and wishing before. But after this miracle, I know without a shadow of doubt that God is with me. If you don't know nothing else, out of all the hell you survived, out of all the tears you managed to muster through, you ought to know for a fact he got your back. Out of all the time they tried to kill you and you didn't die, you ought to know that God is with you. I beg my boss man and showed up. I didn't tell your neighbor he kept it from killing me. Hallelujah. He said, I'm going to give you clarity in spite of the calamity. But then I'm going to cancel the conspiracy. Notice what the text says. I'm almost there. Now I know for a certainty that God has sent his angel to deliver me out of the hand of Herod. The expectation of the Jews. Let's say it again. He said, God has delivered me. And this deliverance is twofold. He's delivered me out of the hand of Herod. Herod is the one that's trying to kill him. God delivered him from the one that tried to take him out. God delivered him from the one that wanted him dead. But not only that, God delivered him from the expectation of the Jews. God said, your next miracle is twofold. I'm going to give the ones that's killing you and the ones that just sitting back watching. Because some folk ain't doing the killing. They just sitting back waiting for you to die. But God sent me to tell you that this next miracle is for the watchers. You still don't know when to shout. I dare you to look at somebody and tell them, this miracle is for the watchers. The ones that are watching me, waiting for me to go under. God is getting ready to disappoint your enemy. God is getting ready to disappoint every strategy. No weapon formed against you shall be able to prosper. I dare you to lift your hand and tell him thank you. Hallelujah. The Bible said that the door is opened. And when this door opened, he canceled the conspiracy. This is the season of open doors. I know you can't receive that because you're in a pandemic. But this is the season of open doors. But you have to observe the door. Let's try this again. You got to have discernment for the door. You have to discern the door. I was in New Orleans. I was going to the mall. And there was a sign on the door that I didn't pay attention to that said, use the of the door. But because it was an automatic door, it opened anyway, so I walked through. The preacher who was with me said, you don't suppose to go through that door. I said, it opened, didn't it? And the Holy Ghost said to me, just because it opened doesn't mean it was ordained. I don't want what's open. I want what's ordained. I dare you to look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, I can't afford to miss it this time. Hallelujah. The Bible says, I'm almost there, that God canceled the conspiracy. Now it's time for them to claim what they confessed. The Bible said that Peter comes to the door. Here we are, let's travel a little while. He comes to the door. The Bible says that he knocks on the door. And the damsel by the name of Rhoda comes to the door and hears Peter's voice. The Bible says that when she hears his voice, she runs with gladness. She didn't see him. She didn't touch him. She simply hears the voice and got glad. You got to check your spirit when you're no longer excited to hear your leader's voice. You gotta check your spirit when your leader's voice don't move you anymore. Look at how y'all looking at me. The Bible said that she runs with gladness. She leaves Peter at the door because she's excited. You need some people in your life that's so happy about your miracle that they'll take off running and dancing. The problem with many of us is we're connected to people who pretend to love us. Look at how y'all looking at me. But I came to rebuke fake love. I dare you to look at your neighbor. I tell your neighbor, I can't have no fake love. Glory to God. I'm talking about those people who are friends with you and your enemies. I'm talking about those people who smile in your face and throw shade behind your back. Oh, look at how y'all looking at me. I'm talking about people who downplay your success. The devil is a lie. Before you experience this next level, God is exposing fake love. Do me a favor, rip your hands and tell the Lord, show me. Hallelujah. The Bible says that she runs and she goes and she tells the others, Peter is at the door. They said, girl, Peter ain't at the door. The Bible said that they looked at her and said, you crazy. I'm an inquisitive preacher. I got 5 minutes left. I wanted to know why that they didn't believe. I mean, they had been praying for hours. What is it that caused you not to believe? They were looking, number one, at who had been killed. James, in chapter number, verse 2, had been killed. Which means because he was a leader, they prayed for him too. But they prayed for him and he still died. So it's hard for them to believe this time, because they didn't get the answer they were looking for last time. Y'all missed it, let's try it again. James had died. So it's possible that they prayed for James and didn't get the answer they were looking for. So could not I believe that Peter would come up, because you disappointed me last time. There's some folk in this room that it's hard for you to believe it's going to work this time. Because last time you didn't get the job. Last time they didn't give you the house. Last time you did lose the car. But God sent me to tell somebody, this help me prophesy to your neighbor. Look your neighbor in the eye and tell him, not this time, not. Glory. Three reasons I'm out of here why they didn't believe. Number one, they were focused on the facts. They were looking at reality, but they weren't paying attention to faith. Yes, your credit's go jacked up. Yes, you don't have the right support. Yes, your family acting funny. But faith trumps facts. Yes, they told you you had the sickness. Yes, they told you you need surgery. But faith trumps facts. I wish I had somebody that knows what the Bible meant when it said we walk by faith and not by sight. Glory. They were focusing on the facts. But then they thought it was already final. Look at what they said to Rhoda. Rhoda, what you're seeing is just his angel. In other words, they thought he had already been killed. And the only thing that he saw was the ghost. They didn't think it was really Peter. They thought his spirit had came. They said, girl, all you see is his ghost. How many times have we given up in prayer because we thought it was already over? How many times have we gotten off of our knees disappointed because we thought it was over? God sent me to tell you it ain't over until God says it's over. I dare you to clap your hands again and tell him thank you. Hallelujah. They were focusing on the facts. They thought it was already final. But then they didn't believe. Because they didn't have faith. It was happening so fast. I'll say it again. They didn't believe. Because they didn't expect it to happen so fast. Rhoda says, Peter is at the door. They said, no, girl, that can't be Peter. Because if that's Peter knocking, that means that God really heard us. That can't be Peter. Girl, you tripping. That can't be Peter. And the reason why that's not Peter is because we're still praying. I'm coming to get you. That's not Peter. Because if that's Peter, that means that God heard us before we could finish praying. That can't be Peter. Here's my topic tonight. That can't be Peter. Because that means he gave us the answer before we could say amen. Do me a favor. Look at your neighbor tonight and tell your neighbor you're going to get the answer before you can say amen. Wouldn't it be wonderful that while you're still praying, the answer will knock at the door? Wouldn't it be wonderful that while you're praying for the job, the phone will ring? Wouldn't it be wonderful that while you're praying for a healing, you get a phone call from the doctor, and they say, I can't find no trace. God sent me tonight on the first night of Convocation to tell you, you're in the atmosphere for answers. Will you do me a favor tonight? Will you look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, you're in the atmosphere for answers. Somebody here tonight, you're frustrated because it seems like the answer hadn't come. You're frustrated tonight because you're still talking to God, looking for God to move, and you don't see no results. But God sent me to tell you that your next miracle is going to happen so fast you won't be able to finish praying. Your next miracle it's going to happen so quick that while you're on your knees, the answer going to knock at the door. Oh, Lord, I came to tell somebody that your answer has been released. Oh, Lord, the Bible says that Daniel prayed to God for 21 days. And the Bible says that when the angel came to Daniel, he told him from the first day that you decided to pray, I heard you. And somebody here, you've been praying for years. Somebody here, you've been praying for months. But God sent me to tell you, I heard you the first time you prayed. Oh, Lord, I'm ready to ride now. Look at somebody next to you and tell them, neighbor, look for the answer. I know you've been praying, but look for the answer. I know that your praying has been tiresome. Your praying has caused you to get weary. But don't stop praying. The Lord is nigh. Don't stop praying. He'll hear your cry. The Lord has promised, and his word is true. Don't stop praying. He'll answer you. Do me a favor. Help me close tonight. Look at somebody and say, neighbor, your answer has been released. That neighbor still ain't happy. Find you somebody that look like they need a miracle. And tell them, neighbor, what you've been praying for has been released. Everything that you've been waiting on, everything that you've been praying about, it's released. God is releasing results. God is releasing healing. God is releasing breakthrough. Your wait is over. Is there anybody here that can testify? I prayed long enough. I waited long enough. I cried long enough. The answer is on its way. I came tonight to tell this house you're overdue for a breakthrough. You still ain't happy. Find somebody and tell that neighbor you're overdue. Push me off the cliff. You're overdue for a turnaround. You're overdue for a deliverance. You're overdue. It's already done. Praise him like you already got it. Praise him like it's in your hands. Praise him. Praise him. It's already fixed. long, my God, I don't want to make the wrong decision. I see two options before you, and you're like, God, which one do I choose? The Lord said, tell you, you won't make the mistake of going in the wrong door. He just released insight and clarity. Even now, your employment is shifting. And the Lord said, tell you that in this next season, I'm going to give you what other folks don't think you deserve. I'm going to bless the works of your hands, and your tax bracket just shifted.